one of the last techniques that is called single sideband modulation. Okay, so here what we do, first we generate DSBSC, which means two sidebands. So by using filters, we remove one of the sidebands. Okay, that is called SSB, single sideband modulation. By doing so, we are saving the power as well as bandwidth. But so the advantage of the disadvantage of this technique is we need a sharp filters with a sharp cutoff frequency. Okay, suppose if the filters are not sharp, which means they are having some transition bands, something like this. Okay, so if the filters are practical filters, which means they don't have a sharp cutoff frequencies like this, but instead they have a gradual roll-ups. Okay, so then what happens? Suppose the filters are something like this, instead of ideal, suppose they are something like this. Okay, they are something like this. Let us take. So then what happens? What happens then? So if the filters are practical filters, you get some portion of the other sideband also, isn't it? You can observe here. So this portion also you will get. This portion also you will get. Okay. So same thing with the low pass filter. If the low pass filter is having some roll ups, something like this. Okay. So you get some portion of the other sideband also, something like this. Are you with me or not? Okay. Now, so this leads to one of the last techniques in amplitude modulation, that is called vestigial sideband modulation. What is called vestigial sideband modulation? So how to get that? If the filters are not having sharp cutoff frequencies, if the filters are practical filters, what happens? You get some portion of the other sideband also. Here you are transmitting upper sideband, but because of the practical filters or non-ideal filters, you are getting some portion of which sideband? Lower sideband. Okay, so same thing can happen. So what is happening here? So here, what is happening? So because of this non-ideal low pass filter, so you are getting lower sideband and some portion of upper sideband. Correct? Now, so that is called vestigial sideband modulation. What is the vestige? Means a small portion. Okay. Yeah, as mentioned earlier, so the problem with SSBs, we need ideal filters, the sharp cutoff frequencies. It is very difficult to design ideal filters. So because practical filters will have a transition bands, something like this. So actually, so this is the sharp cutoff frequency, but this is the gradual roll off. Practically you will get like this, not like this. Okay, so whenever the filter is having some roll offs or some transition bands, what happens? Something like this. Suppose this is a message signal. So suppose if you want to transmit upper side band, you get almost one upper side band and along with some portion of lower side band also. Okay, or reverse may happen. You may transmit almost one lower side band, you will get some portion of upper side band. Okay, which means, so you don't get complete separation of bands. Okay, so what happens here? You get upper side band along with some portion of lower side band, or reverse. You may get lower side band along with some portion of upper side band. So this portion, the small portion, is called vestige. So that's why it's called vestigial sideband modulation. Okay, so obviously whatever the bandwidth, it will be slightly more than W. Okay, what the bandwidth? Actually from FC to FCW, this is a W, this extra you are getting FV. Okay, so the bandwidth of VSB is little bit more than the bandwidth of SSB. Why? Because we are transmitting almost one sideband and along with some portion of other sideband. Okay. Now what about bandwidth? Yeah, we transmit USB along with some portion of LSB. Or you can, it may happen reverse also, your wish. FE is a vestigial bandwidth. This is the bandwidth of that small portion. So what is the bandwidth of this entire signal will be W plus FE. What is the bandwidth of SSB? Only W. It is W plus some FE. This is FV. Okay. Obviously, it is little bit more than the bandwidth of SSB. Typically, it is around 25% to 33%. Okay. Yeah. So that is about vestigial sideband modulation. Okay. Now. So obviously, what about power? Power also a little bit more than, slightly more than SSB power. Power requirement of VSB is slightly more than the power requirement of SSB. So it is a vestigial sideband modulation. Okay. Please remember, so here I have taken a message signal which is having what? A power at zero frequency. Okay, actually it has got more amplitude at zero. Okay, which means it is starting from zero. It has got significant power at zero frequency. Okay, so if it is so, you get like this. Okay, now so this is about vestigial sideband modulation. Okay, now so how to generate this vestigial sideband modulation? Okay, so the generation is just like VSB, SSB. How SSB generated? You remember, right? First generate DSBSC. How DSBSC generated? Just multiply MFT and CFT. Okay, after getting two sidebands, using filter, you remove another sidebands. That is the logic of SSB. Okay, we use same logic here. Okay, same logic as that of SSB. But only thing is, we have a filter which need not be ideal. If it is ideal, what will happen? You get SSB, because one complete sideband will be separated. Okay. Now, so here very carefully observe these things. Let us take modulator. How we generate VSB? It is just like SSB. Okay. The only thing is here we use a practical filter, which need not be ideal. Okay. With impulse response HIFT. Okay, now what is input to this filter? Okay, first of all, let us generate DSBSC. I am multiplying MFT with CFT. Okay, this is where this is at this point you get DSBSC. Okay, now after getting DSBSC, we are passing through a non-ideal high pass filter. Okay. So then you get X of T. Is it okay? Here, what is X of T now? You observe something like this. So input to the filter is, this is a low pass, high pass filter with impulse response HI of T. Input is M of T into C of T. Output is, let us take X of T. So what is X of T? Obviously, from the property of LTS systems, X of T will be M of T into C of T convolution what? HI of T. So this is the output of modulator. This is VSB signal. Is it okay? Now, so what about demodulator? You transmit this X of T, your output X of T over a channel. So at the demodulator, what you receive is X of T. What we do in the demodulator, again multiply with C of T. Okay, at this point, you're getting X of T into C of T and pass through low pass filter, you may get something proportional to up. So this is demodulation. What it is called? What type of demodulation is this? Anyone? What is the demodulation of this? What is the name of this demodulator? Anyone?
Synchronous, sir.
It is obviously a synchronous or coherent demodulator. Why? The reason is synchronous or coherent demodulator. Why? Because so the carrier, the local, the incoming carrier, this is the local carrier, both are having frequency and phase synchronization, or they are coherent in frequency and phase. So if it is, so it is called synchronous demodulator. So everything is exactly same as that of SSB. Here we are using a normal filter whose impulse response is HIFT. But so let me do some calculations. Yeah. So this filter is called vestigial shaping filter. The name of this filter is vestigial shaping filter. Okay. Obviously, what is x of t? Output of this modulator is m of t into c of t convolution h I of t. What is h I of t? Impulse response of this non-ideal low pass high pass filter. Sorry. Obviously, if I take some Fourier transform of x of t, what do you get? Something like this. Okay. So what is x of f? Okay, x of t, x of f. What do you get? M of f plus fc plus m of f minus fc into h I of f. Okay. Anyway, off will be there. So okay. This is the spectrum of what signal? Modulated signal x of t. That is x of f. Okay. Now, so let us go to the demodulator. Again, x of t is multiplied with c of t and passes through low pass filter. What happens? So this is r of t. Let us take. What is r of t? X of t into c of t. What is r of f? You know already. Yeah, so this is R of F. You observe things very carefully. I will give some time. So R of T is X of T into C of T. What is R of F? Obviously, 1 by 2 X of F minus FC plus X of F plus FC. Is it okay? That is the property of modulation or frequency translation property or frequency shifting property. But what is X of F? This is what X of F. I'm substituting x of f in this equation. You get something like this. Okay. But this r of t is passed through low pass filter with a bandwidth w. Is it okay? So here, what is the purpose of low pass filter? It eliminates frequencies which are more than its cutoff frequency. So what will happen? Which are eliminated? So m of f minus 2fc into h of f minus fc. So these two terms will be eliminated because they are shifted to higher frequencies. Okay. So after low pass filter, this output. This output. Okay. But output of demodulator should be what? Anyone? What is the ideal output of demodulator should be? Will answer this. What should be the ideal output of any demodulator? It should be m of t, message signal. Okay. Now here, so in this expression, what do you got? 1 by 4 m of f into some term. So for a faithful reproduction, this should be a constant. What should be constant? So I forgot to write h I. This h I. Okay. H I of f minus f c plus h I of f plus f c should be a constant. typically we take it to be 1. Why? Because if this is a constant, what is R of f? 1 by 4 m of f. So this should be a constant. You observe the things very carefully. If this is a constant 1, obviously what is R of f? 1 by 4 m of f. You are getting 1 by 4th of your message signal, that is also okay. It is proportional to m of f. Or R of t equal to 1 by 4 m of t. Okay. So output of demodulator is proportional to m of t. So this is very, very, very important. Okay. We as a filter must satisfy what condition? Hi of f minus fc plus hi of f plus fc should be equal to 1. Between minus w to w. Is it okay? So this is a derivation to derive this condition. So please remember, this is one of the important conditions of any modulation technique. VSB is very, very simple because we are using a normal filter. We don't need ideal filters, but it has to satisfy one condition. What is condition? This condition, which means you have to design your filter such that it is satisfying this condition. It need not be ideal filters, but ideal filter, but it should be obeying this condition. That's it. Okay. Here, so the only thing is, so this is a modulator. We are just using a filter here. This is called VSB filter. Is it okay? So this filter should satisfy what condition? What is the condition? If hi of t is the impulse response of the filter, obviously its Fourier transform is hi of f. Okay, so this filter at the modulator, okay, it should satisfy what condition? Hi of f plus fc plus hi of f minus fc should be equal to constant, typically it should be equal to 1. So this is what I want to tell you. Very, very, very important. Is it okay? No. So here, what is the advantage of VSB filter, VSB modulation? Let us see. So it is used in television broadcast. Okay, why? So let me explain this. So video signal, you take a video signal. What is the bandwidth of video signal? Anyone? 0 to 4.5. Okay, this is minus, okay. This is a video signal. Let me take. This is a spectrum of television or baseband video signal, which is starting from 0. Okay. So what is the best technique to transmit this video signal? Anyone? As of now, what do you know? Suppose if you take AM, amplitude modulation. What is the bandwidth of AM signal? Twice the bandwidth of message signal. Which means, what the bandwidth of this signal? 4.5 megahertz. If you transmit this video signal using AM, baseband video signal using AM, you require 9 megahertz. This is an enormous huge bandwidth. Okay, so AM is not suitable for transmission of video signal because it uses large bandwidth, 9 megahertz, too much. What about DSBSC? It is also same, 9 megahertz. It is also not suitable because it requires a lot of bandwidth. They are bandwidth inefficient techniques. Okay. What about SSB? If you use SSB, obviously, SSB means only one sideband. That's why you only need 4.5 megahertz. It is good. It is good. But what's the problem? Why can't we transmit video signals using SSB modulation? Anyone?
There is power at zero frequency, sir.
Very good, very good. Why? Because this video signal has got significant power at DC value, at zero frequency. I told you already, if at all there is any power at zero frequency, SSB generation is very, very complex. You cannot generate SSB signal, even though it is occupying less bandwidth, but we cannot generate because it is starting from zero. Okay, it is also not possible. So the only thing is VSB. If you use VSB, whatever the bandwidth, obviously it is more than 4.5, little bit more than 4.5, but not 9 megahertz. It is only 25% more than 4.5 megahertz, maybe around 6 megahertz. You can take something like that, approximately. So it uses moderate bandwidth, but VSB can be generated for any signal, whether it starts from zero or it doesn't matter. Why? Why? Because we don't transmit only one sideband completely. What do? We transmit almost one sideband along with some portion of other sideband also. Okay. Why it is happening? Because of normal filters that we can produce, that we can manufacture. Normal, non-ideal filters. Obviously, if you use filters with transition, obviously you get some other portions also, right? It happens. Okay. So you just verify, no? You go with the first slide. You take this example. Okay. If the filters are not ideal, obviously what happens? You are getting some portion of the neighboring sideband also. Okay. So that is nothing but VSB. So VSB is most suitable for transmission of television baseband video signals. What is the basic reason? It occupies moderate bandwidth and generation also easy. Okay. So these two are not suggestible because they're wasting a lot of bandwidth. Okay. Now, so that is about VSB. Okay. It is a compromisation between SSB and DSB. DSB means double sideband. It is just between SSB and DSB. So in DSB, we transmit complete two sidebands. SSB, we transmit only one sideband. In DSB, it is in between. We transmit one sideband along with some portion of other sideband. Okay. Yeah. The baseband video signal occupies enormous bandwidth, obviously. Yeah. SSB is not suitable. Okay. That's why you go for VSB. Okay. So as of now, so for transmission of speech and voice signal, what is the best technique as of now? Will tell me the answer. For transmission of voice or speech, what is the best technique as of okay? That is SSB. For transmission of video signal, what is the best technique? VSB. Okay. So as simple as that. For audio, SSB, for video, VSB. Okay. So what happens is in television, you need to transmit both. Because just by looking at video, what do you get? You get nothing. We need to transmit both. In television, what do you receive? Your audio as well as video. Okay. So generally what we say, for video, we use VSB. For audio, we can use SSB. As of now, still we have to discuss a lot more techniques. I am very optimistic about this. I'm just telling as of now, this is the logic. It could be vary depending upon further courses. Okay. Right. Okay. So with this, we complete the amplitude part of modulation. So basically amplitude modulation, it is four types. DSB AM, simply we call AM, but it should be DSB AM. Why? Because double sideband AM. That's the first technique we have discussed. DSB SC. Okay. In this technique, we had two sidebands, one carrier at FC. We have removed carrier, we call it as DSB-SC, which has got only two sidebands. In SSB, we remove one of the sidebands, we call single sideband modulation. In VSB, we transmit one sideband completely, almost completely, and some portion of other sideband also, some part of other sideband also. So this is about VSB. All these are called linear modulation techniques. All these are called linear modulation techniques. Okay, why they are called linear? You have to verify. Okay. So you do one thing. You take something like assignment. So you write some of the advantages and disadvantages of all these techniques, all four techniques. Make it as an assignment. Okay. So try to write the advantages and disadvantages of all these techniques. As I told you already, it is always about trade-off. Okay. So there is, in general, there is no best technique. There is no ideal technique. It is always about trade-off. The trade-off depends upon application. Okay. Right. So that is about amplitude modulation. So here we are varying the amplitude of the carrier according to the message signal. That is the one type of modulation. I told you starting itself. The basic parameters of any signal are amplitude, frequency, phase. So till now we have varied amplitude of the carrier by using some techniques. Okay, that is about amplitude part of modulation. Next, we'll vary. Okay, one more thing. So by varying amplitude, we are keeping remaining two parameters, frequency, phase, constant. Is it okay? So the frequency, phase of all these techniques is same. We are not doing anything with the frequency phase. We are only changing the amplitude of the carrier till now. Next, the next techniques, we change frequency and phase by keeping amplitude constant. Okay. Anyway, so this is about amplitude modulation. Any doubts, you can ask me. I'll give 5 minutes. Any doubts? I am free now. You can at least message me and you can ask me.
Sir,
tell me.
Sir, in order to use VSB technique, there is some condition, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. What do you mean by that condition?
Yeah, the condition is.
Does it bandwidth?
No. It is just
amplitude.
Okay, very good question. Actually, it simply says this transition, this roll off should be symmetric, which means you are observing this orange color, no? This orange color should be same as this blue color. Are you getting? So this transition about FC should be symmetric. Okay. Let me write here. Otherwise, so here. So I'm taking this a filter, low pass filter, for example. Okay, it should be is ideal filter, but if it is particle filters, it has got some roll-ups, no? Something like that. Okay, I am not good at drawing, please bear with me. So actually at FC, let me take this FC. Okay, so this portion, it is not drawn up to the scale. This portion should be same as this portion, obviously. This portion should be same as this portion. It is some kind of mirror image. It should be a mirror image about this carrier frequency FC. Okay, so it is nothing to do with the bandwidth of frequency, just how it is rolling off. This is called roll off. How it is rolling off? The rolling off should be symmetric about FC, this carrier frequency. Is it okay? Right.
Okay, sir.
Anything else? Okay. Right. So let us move on to the next type of techniques, that is called angle modulation. What is called? Angle modulation. Angle means it is two types. Either you can vary frequency or you can vary phase. So if the frequency is varied, it is called FM. The phase is varied, it is called PM. Frequency modulation, phase modulation. Now, what is angle? Theta of t is called angle. So here, what are you writing? Cos theta, AC cos theta of t. In this, theta of t is called generalized angle. Now, Here we have a FIRT, that is instantaneous frequency. So please observe these terms very carefully. They are a little bit confusing, but don't worry. Okay. AC cos theta of t, it is just like a cos waveform, where theta of t is called angle. Okay. Now, so FI of t is called instantaneous frequency. Why I am called instantaneous frequency? Because here we are changing the frequency with time. Obviously, so it should be a function of time. Is it okay? So that's what is called instantaneous. At particular instant, what is the frequency? Okay. Now here, okay. So omega I of t is called instantaneous angular frequency. Obviously, so there is a difference between f and omega, right? F is a frequency, omega is angular frequency. Okay. So f I of t is the instantaneous frequency in hertz. Omega I of t is the instantaneous angular frequency. I hope you are okay with this. What a relation. Relation is very simple. Omega equal to 2 pi f. Obviously, omega I of t equal to, what do you write? 2 pi f of t. F I of t. Okay. So these are two things you must know. In angular modulation, you have an angle theta of t, and you have an instantaneous angular frequency or frequency, okay, that is omega and f. Okay. Now, so there is a statement I have made it very clearly. So instantaneous frequency at any instant t is a slope of its angle. Okay. So what do you mean by this? Instantaneous angular frequency at any time t is slope of the angle at that particular time t. So what is slope means? Taking the derivative. Okay. Now this is a relation between angle and instantaneous angular frequency. Are you okay with this? So you must know this. Okay. So the instantaneous frequency is nothing but slope of the angle. Slope means derivative of the angle. Okay. So omega I of t equal to derivative of theta with respect to t. Okay. So that is a one statement. You must have an idea. So here I have written fi of t. What is fi of t? Obviously 1 by 2 pi d theta by dt. Why fi? Because omega is nothing but what? 2 pi fi of t. If you take 2 pi this side, it becomes 1 by 2 pi. Okay, so I will use fi omega I interchangeably. You don't get confused. Okay, they are both are same, right? Just one is in hertz, another one is in radians. Okay. Radians per second, right? Now, so fi of t equal to 1 by 2 pi derivative of theta. This is one of the important things you must know. What is the logic? The logic is very simple. Instantaneous frequency is nothing but slope of the angle at particular time. Okay. Now, obviously, if you want reverse, these two are related by differentiation. Obviously, if you reverse them, they will be related by integration. So theta of t equal to 2 pi integration fi of theta. So this is one of the important relations in angular modulation. Okay. This or this, both are same, but one is by using differentiation, other one using by integration. Okay. Now, so having said that, so let us proceed for phase modulation. What is that? Phase modulation. What is a phase modulation? Okay. Which means we are changing the phase by keeping amplitude, everything constant. Okay. Now, how it is defined? The instantaneous angular frequency omega I t is varies linearly with the derivative of message signal m dash of t. Okay. So here, what I have written is, initially, we take angle. Okay. Keep it aside. What I have written is, omega I of t equal to it is varying linearly according to the derivative of message signal, which means m dash of t. Okay, so it is proportionate. So typically we write omega I of t equal to omega c plus kp m dash of t. Is it okay? Right. Now, so what is kp? Kp is called phase sensitivity. Okay, so this is omega I of t. From omega I of t, how to get theta of t? Anybody? From omega I of t, how to get theta of t? What the logic?
Integrated.
Yeah, integration. You integrate this. You get this omega c into t plus kp. So what is integration of m dash of t? It is m of t. Okay. So this is the angle. This is the instantaneous angular frequency of phase modulation. Is it okay? So you need a little bit of practice to write everything. You must write this on a piece of paper, otherwise you will get difficulty. Okay. So now you got a relation between theta of t is omega c t plus kp m of t, omega I of t equal to omega c plus kp m dash of t. So theta of t you got ac cos 2 pi of c is a unmodulated carrier. Okay, now theta of t is the angle. What is omega c? It is a carrier frequency. Okay, now what is s of t? Is nothing but ac cos theta of t. I mentioned here it clearly. Angle modulation means AC cos theta of t. It could be phase or frequency. Okay. Now, where theta of t you replace with omega ct plus kp m of t. So, what is S of t now? AC cos 2 pi f ct plus kp m of t. That is simple equation of phase modulation. What is the phase modulation equation? S of t equal to AC cos omega CT plus what? KPM of t. This is the equation of phase modulation. Let me write clearly otherwise. So S of t equal to AC cos omega c t is kp m of t. Now, so here what is the amplitude of the signal? AC. It is a constant. Okay. Now, here, so is it linear or non-linear? Is it linear or non-linear? How to check this? You take as a system. It is a system. Phase modulation. Input is x of t, sorry, m of t. Output is s of t. Is it linear system or non-linear system? Who will tell the answer? M of t is inside the cos theta.
Non-linear.
It is inside the brackets of cos theta. Obviously, it is non-linear. So FM, PM are said to be non-linear techniques. But whereas the last techniques we have discussed are all are linear techniques. You have to verify them. Okay. Now this is the equation of PM. Phase modulation. Is it okay? Okay, you just remember like this. So the instantaneous angular frequency is proportional to derivative of m of t. Omega it is proportional to m dash of t. Omega it equal to omega c plus kp m of t. Obviously theta of t equal to omega c t plus kp m of t. Okay, that's very very simple. Okay, now here. Next, frequency modulation. The instantaneous frequency of the carrier is modulated by amplitude of the message signal. Here, what happens now? Fi of t is proportional to m of t. Here, fi of t is proportional to m of t, or omega it is proportional to m of t. There, in phase modulation, what happened? Omega it was proportional to m dash of t, the derivative of m of t, but here it is proportional to only m of t. So omega it equal to omega c plus k f m of t. Okay, obviously by integration, what happens? Omega c t plus k f integration 0 to t m of tau d tau. What is k f? Okay, by this time you might be aware with kf. What is kf is called? What it is called? Frequency sensitivity. Ka in amplitude modulation, we are ka, that is called amplitude sensitivity. Kp means phase sensitivity, kf means frequency sensitivity. Now what is theta of t? This is theta of t. Obviously, what is the FM equation? This is FM equation. So omega ct is nothing but 2 pi f ct, correct? Ac cos 2 pi f ct plus 2 pi kf 0 to t m of tau d tau. Okay. Now here, so I have written PM and FM. Okay, so what is the difference? Here we have m of t, here we have an integration of m of t. Okay, so they have a same amplitude and they have same center frequency. Here also, here also, fc fc. Is it okay? Now, so you just take a piece of paper and try to apply the logic. Okay, nothing more than that. So the only logic is, in phase modulation, omega it is proportional to m dash of t. Here, omega it is proportional to m of t. From omega it, you get theta of t. If you know theta of t, you can write the equation straight away. AC cos theta of t. So this table which gives you everything. What is fi of t and what is theta of t? Is it okay? So here we need a practice. Okay, you cannot understand everything by just looking at the slides. You take a paper and try to derive everything. Okay, they're very easy, no doubt. Is it okay? Yes, this is a, just now I told you, fi of t is proportional to m dash of t, it is proportional to m of t. That is about fm and pm. So this is the final thing. AC cos theta of t is nothing but angular modulation. It could be frequency and phase. What is the phase equation? What is the frequency equation? Everything is very clear to you. Is it okay? Correct? Now here, so let us understand FM and PN clearly. Here FM and PM are very similar, but they are inseparable. They are very much similar. Okay, what is the only difference they have? Here it is M of T in PM, you have M of T in FM, we have a integration of M of T. Obviously KP, KF are something like arbitrary constants. Okay, they don't have much significance as of now. The basic difference is M of T and integration of M of T. So apart from that, there is no much difference. They are similar actually. Okay. Yeah. So let us come to the generation. Okay. How to generate FM and PM signals? Before generation, let us understand the how similar they are, how close they are. Okay. So yeah. So read the statement properly. FM signal may be regarded as a PM signal in which the message is integration of M of T in place of M of T. Is it okay? So in FM, if you assume that input is integration M of T, it is nothing but PM. Okay, so you don't get confused by these terminologies. What I want to say is they are very similar. Okay, so let us see how similar they are. Observe these two equations very carefully. Okay, so let us look at the similarity. So this is a phase modulator, which means it generates PM signal. Understood? PM signal means, okay, so let us go with this. So yeah, I have phase modulator PM. If input is M of T, output is S of T. What is the phase modulated waveform? This is a phase modulated waveform. Here S of T would be AC cos omega CT plus KP M of T. This would be generated. Okay? Is it clear? But to the phase modulator, instead of applying signal directly, I'm applying this message signal M of T. Here we have M of T. I'm integrating M of T. At this point, what do you get? Integration of M of T. Now, input of this PM is phase modulator is not M of T, but integration of M of T. Now, what is output would be now? So input is not M of T here. Instead of M of T, I'm applying integration of M of T, that is M of tau. So the output would be what now? What output you get? AC cos omega CT plus KP integration of M of tau datum. So except this constant, which is arbitrary in nature, everything is same. Correct. So that's why it is simply frequency modulation, not phase modulation. You agree not? So the output is FM wave. So this is how they close are. Okay, which means I can use a single modulator to generate both waveforms, FM and PM. Okay, how? You remove this integrator. You apply directly M of T. You get PM signal. You integrate and apply to the PM. You get FM wave, which means they're very, very similar. So you just take M of T, integrate, apply to the PM modulator, you get FM waveform. Isn't it? So that is a similarity. You can do reverse also. Okay, what reverse? This is the frequency modulator. What do you mean by that? Obviously, you take only that FM modulator. Input is M of T. If input is M of T, output is s of t. Now thus s of t would be what? AC cos omega ct plus kf integration of m of tau d tau. This is what you get, but I am not applying m of t directly. What I am doing, I am taking m of t, I am differentiating m of t, you get m dash of t at this point. Now you are applying m dash of t to the frequency modulator. What will happen? Your input is not m of t, but instead of m of t, I am applying m dash of t. Here what happens? Integration of m dash of tau. Integration, differentiation, they will cancel out each other. Output would be what? What output do you get? AC cos omega ct plus 2 pi kf m of t you get. But this is similar to what equation? Phase modulation. Except this constant, okay? No problem. Generation of PM wave using frequency modulator in reverse, FM wave generation by using phase modulator. Okay? Which means if you have one modulator, it is enough to generate two modulations. Either you design FM modulator or phase modulator, that is enough. We don't need separate modulators because they're very, very, very similar. Okay, that is the difference. Is it okay, all of you? So that is about generation of FM and PM by one modulator. One is enough. We don't need separate modulators. Okay, so any doubts as of now? Please respond. So if you don't have any doubts, let us proceed further. Okay, right. Now here, okay, so what is happening actually in this? What is happening? Okay. So let us take instantaneous frequency fi of t. Okay, how we are writing fi of t? Fc plus kf m of t. Okay, this is in case of frequency modulation. So what is the maximum value of this instantaneous frequency? Fc plus, suppose m of t is, let us take am cos omega mt. Now what is this maximum value of this signal? Anybody? What is the maximum of m of t? Am. What is the minimum of this fi of t? Fc minus kf am. Isn't it? So which means this is the shift in the frequency. What happens here is you take something like this. Okay, so how the carrier frequency is changing? What is the actual frequency? Fc. But it is shifting between these two values. What is this value? Maximum value. What is maximum? Fc plus kf am. What is the minimum value? This value, Fc minus kf am. This is the frequency variations. So we have variation around Fc. It can go up to Fc plus kf am, or it can come down to Fc minus kf am. This is the frequency variations. Because amplitude is same, we have to show variation frequency only, right? This is how frequency varies. frequency varies around fc. So if there is no modulation, it is fc. If there is a modulation, it can swing between fc plus kf am and fc minus kf am. Okay, so this is called deviation. This is called deviation. This is how, this is a amount of deviation. Okay, so from fc it going up to fc plus r minus kf am, this is the deviation in the frequency. Okay, now so what is the maximum frequency deviation in fm? How to find out? It is called delta f. It is maximum of fi of t minus fc. Okay, maximum of fi of t minus fc. What is fi of t minus fc? Yeah, in fm, what is fi of t minus fc? Fi of t equal to fc plus kf m of t. What is fi of t minus fc? Kf m of t. Okay, kf m of t. So maximum of mod of m of t, it is called peak frequency deviation or maximum frequency deviation. Okay, now in pm, in pm what is fi of t minus fc? It is kp by 2 pi m dash of t. Kp by 2 pi m dash of t. So it is kp by 2 pi m dash of t. Kp by 2 pi maximum of m dash of t. Now this is the final table which gives you the peak or maximum frequency deviation in fm and pm. It is kf mod m of t. It is kp by 2 pi mod m dash of t. Is it okay? Okay, any doubts? So you just need to concentrate on the equations properly. Okay, they are very, very important. Correct? Now so this is about peak frequency deviation. Is it okay? Now we have something called for sinusoidal measure signal or for tone modulation. Tone modulation means obviously m of t should be am cos 2 pi fm t. Okay, now what is delta f? Okay, so if m of t is am cos 2 pi fm t, what is the maximum of m of t would be now? Am. Now it is kf into am. Okay, now so if it is okay, otherwise I will solve this. Okay, so delta f is equal to what? That is called peak frequency deviation or maximum frequency deviation. It is kf mod m of t. I am not writing maximum because always we take maximum only. It is in case of fm. In pm, what is the formula? Kp by 2 pi mod m dash of t. Are you with me or not? Okay, this is in case of pm. If you take a tone modulation as an example, so what is m of t? Am cos omega m t. Obviously what is m dash of t? What is that? Am omega m. Omega m is 2 pi fm sine omega m t. Plus or minus, don't have any problem. Are with me or not? Is it okay all of you? Yeah, this is nothing but omega m. Okay, now what is m dash of t maximum? Am. What is maximum of m dash of t? What is that? Am 2 pi fm. AM two pi FM. Okay. So what is delta F in case of FM? KF mod M of T. What is mod M of T? AM. KF AM. This is in case of FM. Okay. In case of PM, what do you get? Delta F equal to KP by 2 pi. What is mod of M dash of T? AM 2 pi FM. Two pi cancels. What do you get? KP AM FM. This is what I will tell. Are you okay? Is it clear? Okay. So here the fundamental difference is, in case of FM, delta F is proportional to what? Amplitude of the M of T, that is modulating signal. And it is independent of FM. It just depends upon only amplitude. Okay. But in case of PM, delta F depends upon both amplitude of the message signal as well as frequency of message signal. Okay. Right. So any doubts, you can ask me now. So otherwise, if you don't have any doubts, we'll stop here.